Thank you so much. Thanks. Yeah, don't expect too much. Maybe it's after lunch. It's hard, you know, to go through all the talks today. So maybe why don't we take a minute? I mean, if you want to stand up and stretch a little bit just before this talk, you know, like feel free. You know, that's okay. It's been two intense days of activity. So, well, thank you so much, Javier, for the introduction, and thank you so much for the invitation to come to Barcelona. I very much enjoy the thesis presentations yesterday and be part of that process. And today the talk's been fantastic, so thanks a lot. The title of the talk is Some Thoughts on the How, When, and Why of Music Informatics Research. If the order seems a little bit strange, it's meant to be, so I want to talk primarily about the how we do music informatics research, because I think that's the question that motivates most people in the community and the thing that we focus the most over the years. So, you know, we have these big heated discussions about, you know, should we use an RNN or the constant Q spectrum or the modulation spectrum or the bar pointer model. And sometimes I feel to the detriment of really thinking what exactly is it that we're doing and why we're doing it, you know, so what's the objective of what we do? I mean, of course, these are things that we address, but sometimes maybe not as rigorously as we could, and part of the talk is going to be about that. This is, of course, not only mentioning examples from my work, but the work of many people in the Music and Audio Research Lab in New York. So the structure of the talk is, as I say, first to talk about the how, and particularly lessons that we have learned over the years working on this, you know, about how to put systems together to do MIR. And I want to focus on two specific aspects, I mean, that of features and of data, right, which I think are two very important components of having a functional MIR system. And then I'm going to try to move a little bit towards, you know, the what and why questions. So what is it that we're doing, you know? Can we just take a step back and maybe think a little bit about the fundamentals of what we do, the assumptions that we make when we do our research, and how that influences what we can and cannot do, you know, and how that could shape research for the future, right? So that's more like a set of like open challenges or questions rather than, you know, a set of solutions for you. So I'll leave it up to you to make of that whatever you wish. Now, I don't have to tell this crowd what MIR is. You're all very familiar with the subject. But I do want to constrain the discussion in the context of this talk to content-based MIR, right? So I'm talking about kind of MIR where you're using computational approaches to analyze, classify, cluster, recorded music primarily, as we've heard through all the talks today, or ranking that music according to some notion of similarity. So, you know, like work on semantic ontologies, you know, there are large parts of MIR which are not really covered by this scope. But it does apply to a wide range of tasks, like things like onset detection, pitch estimation, beat and downbeat tracking, core and instrument identification, music structural analysis, genre mode classification, and, you know, the whole shebang of what makes, I don't know, possibly like 75% of ISMIR every year, right? So it's a lot of the community that is reflected in this set of tasks. And I'm going to take a very simplistic, high-level view of, you know, these kind of systems by saying that you could describe them in terms of like two main blocks of operations. So one being, you know, just taking the recorded audio, projecting it into some space of features, you know, where you hope that the characteristics that you want to highlight are emphasized and everything else is de-emphasized. And then you give that to some more, you know, domain-agnostic technique for classification or ranking, you know, typically coming from the machine learning community, in order to produce some labeling or some output that has some musical meaning, or so you will hope, right? And so, again, you all guys know what I'm talking about here, you know, so if you're doing core recognition, you take your chroma, you put it into a GMM, HMM system, you know, voila, you have an MIR system. Or if you're doing general recognition, the first thing that you do is that you put an MFCC with an SVM and, you know, get the 225th paper on the subject out there, right? And you know, this has been commoditized, right? I mean, like some years ago, we made a research career out of this, but now you just go and download, I don't know, Essentia with Scikit Learns, and, you know, you can put together a system like this very quickly, you know, in your next hackathon, right? So, you know, to some extent, this being commoditized. And I think it's important for us to take a step back about what that means, because I feel that now that people are using, especially with the availability of toolboxes, even data sets where you have a lot of pre-computed features that you can use, sometimes you really don't think about the choices which are embedded in those systems and in those data sets, right? And some of those choices actually have a ton of impact on the success of these systems. Some of them shape the agendas that you can pursue with those tools. And again, you know, I think there is a lot of space for revising, you know, what we're doing and whether what we're doing is the best that we can in the context of the task that we want to solve. So, feature strap, right? You all know the deal, right? So, but let me describe it this way. We can think of feature extraction as basically a series of operations of this form, right, where you have an input, X, you know, a matrix X. You project it into some space using a transformation matrix W1, right? Then you pass that, or may not pass that, through some sort of function, typically a nonlinear function H. Right? And that gives you some intermediate representation. Right? So in this case, X is a linear frequency spectrogram. W1 is a constant Q filter bank. Maybe you pass this through a log operation, right? So you get a log frequency spectrogram in dB. Okay, maybe. And then you can do this again, right? So you take the input Y1 of the first layer. You pass it through another transformation, which is W2, that basically aggregates information from the same pitch class across octaves. You pass it through another nonlinearity, and then you get a chroma representation, right? So, and then you have other things. I mean, this is not the whole story. You have a bunch of other operations, like normalization, maybe between the layers, some smoothing, like low-pass filtering, or some pooling operations. You know, maybe you aggregate in shorter time frames, and then you do some median, max pooling, or some mean operation, right? So you have a certain structure that we follow for almost all the features that we use. I mean, I'm giving you the example of chroma here, but I could very well substitute a couple of things here and give you an FCC, or I could give you another pattern, or, you know, a lot of the features that we know and love, they follow this type of operation. And the details of the operation are very important, right? So my favorite example of the work that we've done is some work that Taemin Cho led in our lab some years ago, and that is in a publication from 2014, core identification. And what he did was that he really systematically studied the impact of all these different choices that you make throughout this operation, right? So what happened if you change the transformation of W1, right? So he tried a number of different changes to W1. What happens if you change the nonlinearity H, right? So how does that affect performance? What happens if you change the parameter of a smoothing operation that you perform, right? If you do a different type of pooling in your computation of the features. And what is very interesting is that, you know, when you run that, he found that he could squeeze as much as a 25% performance increase by doing this type of operations. You know? So it's a huge difference, you know, in core estimation. I mean, it's a simple task. He was doing a 24 core identification, you know, so it's not really realistic in many ways. But, you know, you could get really good performance increases. And then he did the same thing with using binary template matching, Gaussian mixture models or single Gaussians, SVMs, you know, networks of HMMs. You know, he tried a huge number of different classifiers. But given that the other factors are fixed, what he found is that there you could squeeze up to like 5% performance increase. So this is a huge difference here, right? So you can do a lot by manipulating your features. And depending on the features that you have, there is only so far that you can go with a classifier on top of that. And this is very interesting because I think we've changed, you know, for a number of reasons over the last few years. So we're in the process of changing philosophy as a community. But, you know, if you think about what's going on in MIR, let's say for, you know, the previous 10 to 15 years from this study, you will see that the vast majority of publications is all about changing classifiers, putting ever more powerful classifiers while making very strong assumptions about the features. That's not to say that there are not changes in the features, right? I'm sure that every single paper that you look at, you know, that they say, I use chroma, they use a slightly different version of chroma, right? But sometimes that's not even discussed. You make that as a given that that's not important for us to understand exactly how you go to that particular representation. And I would say that that's the most important part of that paper, right? You can get that chroma right, that will explain the difference in results that you're getting, right? So I think my argument here is that features are important, right? And they are very important. They are important with exclamation mark, right? I will argue, my position is that they are the single most important thing in your system, right? But they are very hard to optimize. I mean, think about the simple features that I just gave you, right? They have these two these transformation matrices, W1 and W2. There are many, I mean, these things are high dimensional, right? There are many potential variations of those two matrices that I could propose that maybe will give you a performance edge, but we don't know because, I mean, when you run a systematic experiment on all these variations, there's only so many variations that you can test, right? So doing this exhaustively is pretty hard. So there should be, and there are, more clever ways of doing it, right? And of course, you know where this is going. So again, you can think of all this feature extraction process as basically the combination of two types of operations, right? So as I mentioned before, in the one hand, you have this pooling, smoothing, normalization operations, right? Like the average of this neighborhood, maybe some downsampling, maybe maximization. You know the drill. And transforms of a form y equal h of ws plus b, right? Which, of course, has a very nice implementation in the form of a neural net that has been around for several decades now. And it's a generalization of basically all the different types of transforms that we normally apply when doing, you know, feature extraction in MIR. Not only in MIR, but in many other domains as well. So basically what we've been doing already for decades is finding ways to optimize this stacking of different layers of these different types of operations. But we've been doing this the hard way, right? We've been doing this, you know, through several iterations of PhD students and, you know, theses and papers and, you know, painful mistakes that we make along the way, right? What's that? Yes, yes. And you know, it goes very slowly, and it's not optimal in many ways, right? And of course, there are ways in which we can do this by leveraging stuff which is coming out of the optimization of machine learning literature. You know, things like stochastic gradient descent, you know, like, I mean, there are many methods out there which now are proven to help you do this optimization in a much more efficient manner. And of course, once you do that, you open yourself up to the possibility that, you know, you don't have to constrain yourself to a couple of layers, but you can really start to add more and more complexity to your systems. But, and I will really say this is very important, it's very important for this community, that's also a huge space of design, and this is where your knowledge about the problem that you have and the signals that you're treating is very important. Because despite of everything that the machine learning community might tell you about these things solving everything and cooking your meal, the truth is that you still need to know a lot about how to design one of these systems to work well, right? I mean, they don't work out of the box. They almost never do, right? So there is a lot of domain knowledge that goes into this. It just goes at a different level of design. So over the last few years, we've been doing in the lab a lot of work on deep learning, particularly with convolutional nets. We like convolutional nets. We came out of the DSP. Space, or, you know, we can think of this as filter banks, so we feel comforted by that. Once you start talking about recurrent nets, we get, you know, a little bit shifty, because that's a change of paradigm, you know, and we're still, you know, dealing with it. But, you know, convolutional nets we like, you know, and there are many possibilities in the design of CompNets, and we've been doing this for a while for problems like core identification, instrument identification, both single instrument and in polyphonies. We've been doing this for source identification in urban sounds, for identifying bird species in environmental recordings, for whale recognition in submarine recordings. We've been doing this for rhythmic analysis. You know, so it's a wide range of tasks, downbeat tracking, with Simon Duran in telecom. So, you know, it's a wide range, and in many of those spaces, we found considerable improvement over what we had before, right? So I think there's a lot of power to these tools. And I'll just give you a quick example of this. And this is a one that I really like, because it's a convolutional net. And I think it was André that mentioned before that, that mentioned before that once you start to train a monster like this, it's very hard to interpret what is going on. So, but one of the things that we try to do is to impose as many constraints as we can to try to derive some understanding of what is going on. I mean, this is by no means a done deal or a simple thing to do. But in this particular example, we took an idea from early computer vision work using deep learning on trying to impose certain constraints on the penultimate layer of a network. So in this case, we force the penultimate layer of a network to actually behave like a guitar neck, which is being played by someone, so you can only have one string live at a certain time. You can only have chords, you know, like people pressing on two frets which are a certain distance from each other, right? So you impose a certain number of constraints on that are, you know, driven by your knowledge of this. And although the system is not optimized to give you a guitar tab, it is optimized to give you a core symbol, which is the only data that we have to train the system with. As a byproduct of learning to identify the core symbols, it gives you a guitar tab. And it looks like this. Okay, so you get the idea. So, yeah, I mean, it's not perfect. I make mistakes, as you can see. Of course, it's a track it's never seen, but there are drums, there is bass, there are vocals on top. Still, you know, you're trying to retrieve a chord sequence out of that, you know, like as you will play in the guitar. It plays a little bit like, I mean, the joke I usually make is it plays a little bit like my 13-year-old nephew. You know, it's, again, it's a little bit naive in a place, but, you know, it's a very naive set of constraints that we are imposing on this. So it's very interesting because these are features, right? These are things that the machine is producing through a cascade of all these processes. It's just that in this particular layer of features, we're imposing some constraints to try to, like, derive some interpretability out of it. After that, it performs a classification stage, right? So we use this as an input to a classifier saying, oh, this is C major, this is C major 7, or whatnot, right? So there is, you can control to a certain way a process which is kind of unwieldy in order to produce some meaningful information, right? And that's something that has worked out also very well for us and I think for others in the community. So the second message of the day, the first one is that features are very important. The second one is that learning your features is a very powerful avenue for you to do the most out of the systems that you're doing. And again, you know, and particularly, I will argue, learning convolutional features through convolutional methods gives you a huge potential in representational space, you know, a large ability to model very complicated processes. Now, this is all nice and well and inspiring, but of course, it's not the whole story. These things are very data hungry, as you know very well, and that limits significantly the number of problems that you can tackle with these kind of techniques, right? So this has been a theme of discussion for these 2 days, right? So you either have something really exceptional, like the effort of a CompMusic project to collect the amount of data and the amount of annotated data that's been producing for the last few years at a very large cost in money and in people and expertise, or you limit yourself to tasks where that data somehow comes from heaven, right? So from BlastFM heaven or, you know, from Econest heaven, right? Something like that. And there is a space in between of many problems that this community is interested on where we simply don't have the data to develop machines, to train machines like this, to give us proper solutions to these problems. So, and just to put this a little bit into context, some years ago we started a project that we called MetlyDB. So MetlyDB was an effort to try to produce high quality data for some problems which requires so much effort in annotation that are very hard to annotate from full mixtures. So it's easier to annotate them from separate tracks, right, in a multi-track environment. So we started to collect multi-track sets, some of which were donated to us, some of which we negotiated with, you know, third parties, some of which are produced in the studios in the program that we work on. And then, you know, once we have these multi-tracks, and it takes a lot of effort to curate them and put them in a format that is usable for people, plus getting people to sign on copyright, you know, like Creative Commons licensing that will allow us to share it with you guys and anyone else in the community, then we can run a bunch of automatic approaches on the individual tracks, plus some manual correction in order to produce some sets of annotated data for tasks where that data hasn't been available up to now, right? Or not in this scale. So sample annotations right now include things like pitch for melodies. So we have very precise F0 annotations for melodies, include annotations for source activations over time. So if you want to do polyphonic or multi-instrumental instrument identification with precise localization in time, you know, this is a good data set. Also for things like source separation, it's very useful. And this has taken a lot of time and a lot of people and a big collaboration with folks at Queen Mary and, you know, it's a number of things that we've done in order to get this out. There are right now, in the public domain, 108 songs for melody. There are about 120 tracks in general, but not all of them have melodies. Those are 7.5 hours of melody annotations that took about 50 annotator hours to be generated, right? So that's a lot. And those guys hate us. Like, the annotators that we hire for this, you know, they won't speak to us anymore, right? So they're like, you know, why should I do this? You know, why are you doing this to me, right? And you know, now we're working towards the second release of MetlyDB, which I hope will come out in the next couple of months, and we will hopefully double the size of the data set. But we're still talking peanuts here. I mean, I gave a talk quite recently in a session where there were some guys from Google working on the Magenta project, And those guys are saying, yeah, like the talk just before mine, the guy's talking about, you know, yeah, we had, you know, 700 hours of annotated audio for doing this, and we're trying in this 50-layer network. And then they were talking about speech, and they're saying, yeah, we have like 3,000 hours of annotated audio for this. And then we're like, yeah, I have 7 hours, right? And this is all. This is by far the largest data set that we have for melody annotations, and probably the largest that we have for instrument identification as well. So, you know, like we're really, really far from those numbers, and I just don't see this happening in any much larger scale than this for us to be able to expand this dramatically in the near future, at least, right? Unless you guys have some brilliant ideas on that, which I would love to hear. So I think that we have to be creative here. You know, if we really want to be able to reach the point in data where we can start to leverage these very powerful techniques which are available to us, we really have to come up with alternative solutions. And so the thing that we've been starting to look a little bit more over the last year or so is that of data synthesis and different ways in which we can make the most out of the data that we have. One idea which hasn't been published yet, and this is a work led by Justin Salomon, but also in collaboration with Emilia and other peers in MTG, it's been this idea of taking the multitracks from MetLiDB, you know, isolating voice tracks. Oh, sorry, do I have audio? Oh, sorry, let me do this again. So, okay, so you have your multitrack, right? So it's there on the far left corner, right? So you take the vocal part. Sounds like that. Right, so you can run your monophonic pitch tracker, you can do some cleaning and smoothing, and then you can resynthesize. It's a bunch of artifacts there, you know, it's not perfect by any stretch of imagination, but then we can remix with the original. So that's a synthesized version. Okay, it's a little bit funny, I mean, if you pay attention to it. The good thing is that if you use the resynthesized version, which includes some mistakes in the monophonic pitch tracking, that's fine because you now have perfect ground truth, right? And one of the interesting things of doing this is like, well, you know, like the question that always comes up is like, how much can we tolerate those errors that you're making here? I mean, how unrealistic is the output of this? So what we did was that we took the results of this synthesis process and we used it to evaluate pitch tracking methods comparing against the human annotated ground truth. And what we found is that the difference was statistically insignificant, right? So you could get the same evaluation, you could do the same benchmarking using synthesized data that you can use with human annotated data. And of course, what that means is that in the next iteration of MetLiDB, if we have a bunch of multi-tracks where we have voice tracks, we can run this process and produce, you know, like double or triple the size of MetLiDB much more quickly without the painful 50 plus hours of annotation that we went through in the first stage. So that's something that we're looking into, right? And there are limits to what we can do with this, but you know, this is one path towards expanding the amount of data that we have. Another idea that we've been investing a lot on is that of data augmentation. In 2015, we put out this framework, which is called MUDA, and by we, I mean Brian McPhee, which is a framework for taking audio content and basically passing it through a bunch of different processes which are well known in the audio community, like adding noise, pitch shifting, time stretching, dynamic compression. Right? So you can immediately produce a much larger set out of the original small set that you have in data, right? So if you start to aggregate, you know, and you try to a number of different combinations of these processes, you can easily you know, multiply 100-fold the amount of data that you have, which is exactly what we did for the task of instrument identification, you know, and we wanted to see, does this actually buy us something? And what we saw is that, yes, it buys you a lot, actually. If you take this table, just to explain quickly, the line in the middle, you know, which is marked by the red triangle, is basically the result of a classification with no augmentation, right? So if you have a bar going to the left, it means that when you added the augmentation, the results decrease. And if the bar is going to the right, it means that when you added the augmentation, you improve the accuracy of your estimation. Of course, this was evaluated in data that wasn't distorted, right, on real data. And what you find is you have multiple instrumental classes, right, and you have multiple types of augmentation that you can perform. And what you find is almost overall, all types of augmentation help. But there are some very particular cases where the augmentation actually breaks the consistency of the class, right? And in this case, we have synthesizer class, which is, for starters, very ill-defined, right? Because it includes a lot of different sounds. And you know what we observe is that when you do pitch shifting and when you do when you do pitch shifting and pitch shifting combined with time scaling, you actually break the synthesizer class. So at some point, the distortion, if you think of a manifold where the data lives, at some point the distortion is pushing you across the boundary between that and some other class, or putting you in the no man's land in between, you know, in between the manifold of the data and some space where all you shouldn't live, right? The truth is that we're doing this blindly. We're just applying a bunch of transformations to the audio in the hope that just by virtue of creating more data, we're going to increase the invariance of a machine to some of the variability that you actually observe in the real world. But the opportunity is big, because first, we could start to learn, you know, augmentations as a function of a class that you're trying to classify, right? You could also try to even use unlabeled data just to try to understand what is the actual distribution of the data in the real world and constrain augmentations such that they keep the data within that distribution, right? Or that they replicate the distribution of the real world data, right? And for that, you don't need labels. So it's a lot of like really interesting path for research, and we're starting to explore some of those ideas. But you know, it's something that the computer vision community has been doing for a while, but again, everyone does it ad hoc. So I think it will be very interesting to come up with a set of principles for how to do this right, because we've seen that it has an improvement, right? That you can see significant benefits by doing this. I'll mention also that in the context of urban sound, we actually saw this very interesting phenomenon where we had a simple machine that we developed with unsupervised feature learning using you know, male spectra as input. And we got some results for the classification of sources in urban sounds, in complex acoustic scenes, yeah, in cities. And we got those results, and then we developed a convolutional net to try to solve the same problem, but we never managed to improve performance over the very simple unsupervised feature learning, you know, shallow model that we had. And when we added augmentation, both of those systems improved, but the convolutional net improved multiple times over. So you know, now we have a significant increase in state-of-the-art results in urban noise source identification by being able to provide the machine with enough data to characterize the real variability of those sources in the world, right? Or at least in the world described by the data set. Right? So there is a lot. And I will argue, that data is the single biggest bottleneck that we have as a community. I mean, it's the thing that we actually need more of and better of for us to be able to move forward. Now, just to summarize what I said before, features are important, though they're very hard to optimize by the proper feature configuration. It is a good idea to learn your features. We've seen examples over and over again from multiple labs in the MIR community and other communities that this is a good idea, that these are powerful techniques, and if properly designed, you can get you know, state-of-the-art performance for many tasks. But data is a bottleneck, you know, that you need significant amount of data to make those machines work. So we have to become creative, because that data is not going to simply, you know, come to us. And you know, unless we invest a lot of money in crowdsourcing annotations or finding lots of experts which are willing to use expert annotations, then we need to come up with other solutions. And our solutions so far are in the space of semi-automatic annotations and synthesis of data, right? So those are the things that we've been trying so far. Now, let me shift towards the other part of the talk, which is to take a step back, right? And to think of MIR as a system, right? Where you have multiple parts. So you have some data collection and annotation. You have some development of computational approaches, you know, we spend some time here, and then, you know, if everything goes fine, then you go and use some of your data to evaluate those approaches and make some estimations to where they actually solve the task that you want solved, right? And if we do this right, this should sort of come back, you know, from this process. And we saw a good example from Andre's talk in the selective sampling example, you know, where they actually just go through this loop multiple times, yeah, where they use the results out of the computational approaches to be able to inform data collection in the next stage so that you can improve the development of new computational approaches, right? And so first, it's important for us to close the cycle, and I really think that we need to do more work there. But also, I would say that out of these three stages, we've been spending an inordinate amount of time here and not enough time in those two, right? And I really think that maybe we ought to rethink that a little bit. right? I already mentioned why I think that data is such an important component of a means. But also evaluation, I think, is a widely underserved area of MIR research where, you know, like we're making a lot of very strong assumptions when we evaluate systems. We discussed some of those yesterday in the context of, you know, you have very complicated structures, for instance, in Indian music, at the level of rhythm, you know, symmetrical structures, and there is a lot of information that cuts across multiple hierarchical levels, and yet, when you evaluate, you simply assume a statistical independence of every event. You just aggregate across large collections, and then you have a number, right? That thing tells you you're 90% correct, so, you know, go home, have a beer. But you know, we don't really know if the machine was consistent. We don't really know if the information across multiple levels of a hierarchy connects in a coherent way with each other, right? We don't know if a structure at the signal level is preserved, right? And I think those are important questions for us to ask. So I really would like to finalize the talk today by talking about some of the underlying assumptions that we have. And I will mention two assumptions. One that was alluded to in the discussion with Sankalp yesterday, which is that oftentimes we equate task with data set, right? And this is a very dangerous slippery slope, right? And I'll tell you my own tragic story of doing this. So some time ago, we started working a little bit on the issue of like rhythm analysis for Latin American music, and we decided to use the Latin music data set, you know, which has been around for a number of years. The LMD is the largest, before CompMusic, it was one of the largest rhythm analysis data sets, larger than the ballroom data set. It's 3,000 tracks, labeled with 10 genres. Well, those are the labels that you have. That's all you know about the data set. And the assumption that drives the data set is that rhythmic content in the data is connected to the genre label. Yeah? That those genres are purely and solely defined by their rhythmic content. Okay? That's the assumption that drives the data set and the research that uses the data set. So we started from there, and we're saying, well, you know, yes, let's train a machine. And of course, we came up with some way to apply a learning network to this. And we're very proud when we run this, and we got 90-something percent accuracy on the genre classification task of this, you know. So well done. We had the beer. And then when we came back, we started to scratch our heads and try to think, well, I mean, are we really doing what we set to do? I mean, no, we're not sure. So we started looking at the results, and we found some very interesting things. Like the best performing class in the experiments was Tango, right? We got Tango with like 98% accuracy. And we were very proud of this. Until you start to look at the data a little bit more closely. You realize that in the data set, there are 407 tracks of Tango. But those 407 tracks are only from 7 artists. And out of those 7 artists, actually one of them accounts for 315 tracks in the data set. And that's Carlos Gardel from Argentina. Gardel, well, I mean, you can make a fair argument about this, right? So Gardel is, to many people in Argentina, Latin America, possibly Finland, the embodiment of tango, right? It's kind of like the most famous, you know, tango artist ever, you know, with Piazzolla, perhaps, you know, in a competing role. But Gardel, tragically, he died in 1935. So all the recordings that we have of Gardel, of course, predate his death, for obvious reasons, which means that they were recorded with technology which is not necessarily the same that we have nowadays, right? And one of the manifestations of the technological limitations of the recordings during Gardel era is that they are fairly heavily unlimited, right? So that when you look at the representation that we have, and I'm not going to explain exactly what the representation is, but suffice it to say that this axis here is frequency. If you look at some track from the collection, right? You have information across the frequency range, and of course, it decreases towards the high frequencies, but you still get some information there. But when you look at the Gardel data, you have a very sharp cutoff at some point in the high frequencies. You even have a fairly sharp cutoff in the very low end of the frequency. So, you know, there is a very strong limitation in bandwidth that you can get from these recordings, and it sounds a bit like this. Sorry, that's not loud enough. Right? So you get an idea. Beautiful track. Makes me cry every time. So you see, what we did then was something very simple, right? So we took all the recordings from all the collections, and we computed one feature, right? One feature, which is spectral spread. Right? So for every recording in the collection, we computed a spectral spread per frame and then average, right? It doesn't get any more silly than this, right? And then basically, we just plotted the average spectral spread for all the recordings in the collection per class, right? So you have all the classes in the x-axis, and per class, we look at the average spectral spread for all the items that were correctly identified, for all the items that were false negative. So items of this class that were identified as some other class, and for those that were false positives, you know, so items from other classes that were identified as this class, right? And look at the trend, right? Look at the blue bars for all the classes and look at Tango, right? So it's pretty obvious that, you know, out of the things that were, remember, 98% identified as Tango, they have this huge bias in terms of a spectral spread, right? So this one single feature is a very good predictor of the classification of Tango. Even the things that were confused as Tango, the false positives, you know, from other classes, they have a significantly lower bandwidth than, you know, is normal for their classes. And those things that were Tango and were confusing with something else, they're still low, but they are kind of like getting closer, you know, getting within the bars of some of the other classes. So we basically managed to train the highest dimensional spectral spread computer that is out there, right? This is the least generalizable, non-predictive classifier that you could have for something that we're claiming is Tango, you know, that we're claiming we're learning something about the style, and all that the system is doing is learning spectral spread. Right? We can get exactly the same result with one feature dimension, right? So it's very clear that the machine is not learning what it's supposed to do. Right? So it's a cautionary tale, right? If you trust your data to basically encode the variability of the class that you're trying to model, right, you are opening yourself up to basically learning trivial solutions that have nothing to do with the problem that you're trying to solve, right? If you were to apply this to a real-world collection of Tango recordings, chances are that you will do a terrible job, right? Because the machine didn't learn the right thing, and that was a function of the data set that we use. You know, so look at your data carefully. That's, again, the message there. So let me move to the second and final assumption that I want to revise today, which is that ground truth paradigm. Right? The whole of MIR is predicated in this really particular notion that it's a single ground truth per task that we're trying to solve. And in music, this is a very hard argument to make, right? So what it means is that we're saying, here's Herbie Hancock, right? And you know, his listening of the music puts him here, and here is the expert pygmy musician, right, in the Central African Republic, and he puts him exactly in the same interpretation space as Herbie Hancock, right? And you know, anyone. Like, the fact that you have a mapping between audio and ground truth is completely independent from the person that mediates that mapping, right? That's what we're saying when we say that it's a single ground truth here. And of course, if you have some other track in some other part of the music space, that's going to map to a unique location in the annotation space, right? That's the assumption that we're making. And that's a very helpful assumption for us to make, because then when you train a machine, there is a single one-to-one relationship here which the machine has to learn. You know? That's, again, it's a very convenient assumption and that has sustained the community for a long time. So I'll comment on this with another cautionary tale, which is that of also coming from the same analysis of the Latin music data, which is what I call the Bolero case. And the Bolero case is very particular, right? Because what happened here is that the way the Latin music data set was annotated, it was collected and annotated from a group of dance teachers in the city of Curitiba in Brazil, right? So those guys were teaching lessons of all these genres which are on the data set, and these are the collections that they use to teach those lessons, okay? So, you know, the basic dynamic here is that something is genre X if you can dance the genre X dance to that music, right? That's what drives this. So we started looking at the results, and we started listening to Bolero, and I don't know how many of you, I mean, probably a few are familiar with Bolero. It sounds like this. Mm-hmm. Sounds familiar to anyone? Yeah? Sure? So we know Bolero. If you grew up in Latin America, that will come very natural to you and very familiar to you. You know, it's a very well-known, it's been around for more than 100 years now, you know, so it's a very well-known musical style in the region. There are some very particular identifiers there, you know, so the multi-part voice arrangement, the love theme, you know, the very slow clave on the background, the bongos, you know, marking that clave rhythm. And then, of course, I was very surprised when we stumbled onto this, on the Bolero collection. Right, which, apart from being slow and in a double meter, it's a ballad, it's a pop ballad, it doesn't share any of the other common cultural identifiers with Bolero, right? So maybe for someone who's in the culture, or maybe if you're a percussionist and you're playing this, I mean, you will never say these two things are Bolero, right? But maybe if you're the dance teacher or the dance student in Curitiba in Brazil, or if you like to watch the Dancing with the Stars show on TV, you know, in the US, then, you know, maybe you will think that that's okay to label as Bolero, right? I mean, it's a little bit cringe-worthy for me, but you know, maybe that's a valid assumption to make, right? So there is disagreement between people. There is disagreement. This has been well known for, you know, it's intuitive, I think, for everyone that hears and works with music, but it's also a subject that's been studied in other communities, you know, quite significantly. And I want just to bring a quote from Daniel Mullen-Siefen, who gave a fantastic talk at CompMusic this year, where he say different people respond to same stimulus in different ways and might be equally right. And that's been a subject, one of the subsets of his study in his lab, has been dedicated to this question, right? I mean, how you actually account for the amount of variability of interpretation across, you know, particular musical percepts. And this is very interesting. And when you look at those studies, then you start to scratch your head, because those guys, I mean, they will never publish anything if they don't have 200 responses for one very simple stimuli, right? They simply don't, right? So you know, like, look at the comparison. We have a lot of breadth, right? So we usually work with a lot of data, but we don't have depth, right? We only have one annotator, and we really trust that annotator, and usually it's not one, it's a collection of annotators. It just happened that each one annotates a subset of the data that we have. We hope that they are coherent with each other, and somehow they are the highest possible or valid standard for what a musical interpretation is, right? And so, you know, this situation where we have, you know, multiple interpretations of the same music input is something that the major community hasn't really dealt with in any substantial way. I mean, there are some examples out there. There are some problems, like in music recommendation or in mood estimation, where collecting multiple responses for the same stimulus has been the norm for a while, but it's not widespread. And we're still doing a lot of the tasks that we have, you know, like even some of the tasks that we've been discussing for the last 2 days, and we're still, like, really riding hard on the assumption that it's a single ground truth. And I think there is something to be said about that. So, I think the point that was meant to be done by that line is that even the same person could give you different interpretations at different time in different contexts, right? Which makes the issue even harder to model. So trying to really understand what is the space of potential solutions, I think, is a very potentially rewarding area of research for the community, an area where we can partner with the music cognition folks and really try to get to the bottom and really talk about, like, really intelligent sampling mechanisms. Because, I mean, this is even more expensive than the thing that we're afraid to do now, right? So we really have to be clever about it. There's no way that we can do this by brute force. So, you know, there's a lot of thinking, and I don't have any great solutions about that, I'm sorry to say. But let me try to bring this to a close. This issue of multiple interpretations really brings to question what is the goal of computational approaches. Should they give you all potential interpretations? Should they give you multiple interpretations? Should they give you one interpretation that is somehow reasonable or feasible, or that you might confuse with interpretation of a human? I don't know, right? I mean, it's something that we ought to ask ourselves. And how, I mean, if this is the goal, how do we define what reasonable is, right? How do we define what is a plausible interpretation, right? I mean, we have to come up with some way of defining this. Again, I don't have any great solutions here, but I just want to point out to something that we've been doing recently, which is that we've been spending some time on the evaluation, particularly for music structure analysis. And one of the things that we do for this set that we have is that we have few multiple interpretations per track. So we're looking at patterns of inter-annotator agreement, right? So we're just looking at the distribution, how much the humans in that annotated this collection disagree with each other, right? So we come up with a distribution for that, which is in blue in all the plots here, right? For different data sets, you know, and we have different depths. I think for this we have 5 annotators per track. For this we have only 2, right? And then we do the same between the annotators, the information provided by the annotators, and the information provided by the machine, right? So the green distribution, the red distribution, they are a particular method against humans, right? And the blue is humans against humans. And maybe the purpose of the goal of the automatic system might be to recreate at least that upper bound which is defined by the interhuman disagreement, right? Maybe that's one way to try to account. And by doing it this way, you start to get, well, Joan doesn't agree with me. But, you know, it's an idea. It's an idea. And I think we have to come up with new ideas as to how we're going to deal with this, but I don't think that we're going to get a lot more insight on the tasks that we really know or want to resolve unless we start to cope with this issue. So with that in mind, let me just skip the last 2 and give you thanks. And if you have any questions, please send them my way. Thank you.
Most people agree on the tempo,
right.
And for the track, you disagree. There is up to 4 different versions of tempo.
Right.
Because of course, tempo is it's perceptual mostly. So in the case of the experiment of LastFM, they asked people to tap tempo,
right.
Just in the case. So and what we did, we tried to predict automatically if, from the ambiguity present in the audio content, if people will agree on the tempo or not. So I fully agree that there is not a single ground truth. It depends on the user. But it also deeply depends on what you name the context, which is the application.
Right.
So for the moment, we're trying to solve the major problem of octave error in tempo deletion. So basically, we have a test set of bebop music, which people will have their food on bebop music, usually around 100 BPM. So that means that they will pack the tempo 4 times lower than the real packing because those tracks are around 360 BPM,
right.
Which is the real notation. So that's the one. So that means that here we try to estimate something that people does not even perceive, but because bebop is rated as 360 BPM, we need to obtain this tempo. So what I mean by that is that it's difficult to define the ground truth without the user.
Right.
In some cases, all users will agree, and in many cases, they will not agree. But outside a given context, it's nearly impossible to find an agreement. It really depends on for what.
Right.
So if you want to do playlist synchronization, then you will need 360 BPM.
Right.
If you want to represent the way people have their food, then you will have to.
Right.
So then it's really difficult to do anything without the context of an application. That's what I think.
Yeah, and I fully agree with you, and I skipped the last 2 slides for in the interest of time, but that's where I made the argument that I think one path for this is to really integrate people in the loop, right? Like to try to like merge the role of evaluator and annotator together, you know, and just basically have usage tell you what you need to know about the ambiguity of a certain task and about the range of labels which are useful for a particular context, right? And you know, like there is huge potential for that in the community. There are already systems out there that can do it. You know, one thing that we've been wanting to do for a long time, never got around to do, is to take that system that I showed you for the guitar tabs and just like basically put that in the middle of these websites where, you know, there are millions of guitar tablatures which are provided by people. And people all the time, they correct each other. So there's no reason why they wouldn't comment on the machine the same way that they comment on the output from someone else. And that will give you information that you can, you know, input again into the system. And hopefully through that propagate this to a larger amount of data that they can annotate themselves, right? So I think there is a win-win here if you can inject yourself in the middle of a community that actually has a use for this data, right? But the truth is I'm in MIR for years, maybe because, you know, we were a young field for a while, and I think, you know, we were away from those applications. But I think now that there is the real world uses of MIR out there, you know, pursued by companies and, you know, projects like CompMusic and everything, I think, you know, we really have an opportunity to connect with our user base in a much more direct way. And so yeah, I fully agree with what you're saying.
So with this idea of the one-to-many relations between the possible annotations, mm-hmm. and considering these three areas, which is like the evaluation, the computational approaches, and the data collection, yeah. In which percentage do you think this paradigm shift, so to call, affects each of these three levels? And so for example, when we are doing a BPM evaluation,
right.
There is this accuracy tool measure, which in a way is kind of saying, okay, this result can be good if you consider the optic errors, which is somehow the idea of this annotation space having multiple possible results. Mm-hmm. But the algorithms that we have, maybe they output one estimate, or maybe some algorithms output two.
Right.
So this would be like putting the emphasis either on the algorithm or on the evaluation, mm-hmm. or on gathering the grammars. So which side do you think is?
I mean, I really think that, you know, there is a lot of really good techniques here which are already being proposed and are being developed, you know, so I'm really not concerned about the future of this. I think this work will keep going and will keep getting better. I'm really afraid about what the results of this means if we don't take care of those two guys, right? So I will argue that, maybe you can come up with metrics now that will arbitrarily take care of some potential causes of disagreement, because in a way you know something about the problem, and in most cases because you know something about your system and the type of errors that your system makes, so you account for those in those evaluations. I don't know that really gives you the full spectrum of disagreements that might occur with humans, right? And you know, we've been looking at this in music structure analysis now for a while, and we've been trying to find patterns of, like, one of the things that we found already is that people disagree in terms of, like if you look at Salami, right? A Salami data set, you have basically two levels of annotations of a structure, right? And that is assuming that there are only two levels of annotations of a structure that people can latch onto, which is not true, right? And one of the common errors that, one of the common sources of disagreement between annotators is that they are annotating at different depths in the hierarchy, right? That someone is maybe picking up on motifs, maybe someone is picking up on, you know, bars, right? So they're just simply, they're annotating the same information, maybe using some of the same features as focus, but because they're simply at a different level of the hierarchy, the system characterizes, I mean, the evaluation metric characterizes as disagreement. So we've been working on metrics that take into account that, you know, you could be at different depths and still be part of the same structural organization. And by doing that, you start to see now patterns of disagreement which are real, that actually have to do with someone listening to the harmony as opposed to listening to the rhythm, or someone listening to timbre, putting more attention to instrumental changes across the music. So, you know, we've been starting to see some of that information in partnership with people working on cognition. So I think there is a lot there. I mean, I cannot tell you that this is going to apply equally well to all the problems, but I think for those problems that we know already are sources of disagreement, I think it's very important that we move in this direction.
Please. Just a comment. Right. Because you start your talk by supporting doing features by hand. You do that very well. The evolution of the network, which is data. Right. That was your point. And at the end, you show with the Togo example. Mm-hmm. But actually, you have a problem if the sampling rate of the data, the bandwidth, is not the same.
Right.
So that means that actually, doesn't that mean that the amount of effort that you have put in handcrafted features,
right.
Because in handcrafted features, we really put them directly in the features, doesn't that mean that this amount of work, then you have to put it in checking that your test set exactly represents what you want to write out? Because then you somehow default all the work that you have put in handcrafted features. But even on a larger scale, because here we have 4,000 tracks, something like that.
Right.
But if you have 3,000 hours like Google has, That means that you get to check exactly that the 3,000 hours of annotation exactly represent. I don't know, can you comment on that? Because it's
Let me make 2 points. So the first one is that there is a lot of evidence by the high priest of bad evaluation, which is Bob Storm, that shows that people have been doing feature design and making the same mistakes that we're doing with feature learning for a long time, right? So people are overfitting the data that we have, whether they're doing it with hand design features or whether we're doing it with learned features. That's been true of the ballroom, Sanetakis, LMD, almost every large data set that you can think of in MIR, right? This is not new. This we've been doing for ages, and we seem to be very happy with it. So I will argue that there is no, the fact that you do hand design features doesn't save you from making those mistakes. The second part is that when I argue for more data, it's not simply blindly more data. I think we have to be clever about the way that we get more data, including controlling for very basic factors that might influence the shape of your data. Like yesterday, I kept asking these guys about, I was asking Sankalp about like the dependency with year. On the data, so because this data exists, right? It's there in the metadata somewhere, and it's important. It's very difficult also because they're looking at so many dimensions, right? They were looking at talas, they were looking at artists, they were looking at different schools and styles. There are so many possible dimensions of that. Of course, some stuff is going to fall through the cracks, but the more effort that we put towards controlling for those factors, the more actually that we can squeeze out of the data that we have. So I don't think that just more data for the sake of more data is enough. I think that we have to think carefully about how we collect that data. So.
Yeah, but I think it's actually this hours phenomenon, because if you really think, you say that features learning has been doing this hours effect since decades, but actually not. If you look at the first MIR system, which were using really basic stuff, if you think of Erich Eyler, the tracking system, it's so low level, so perceptually based,
Are you sure? Because I will argue, for instance, that's a good example, right? So Eric Shires was using multiband decomposition. So if you have Tango in that, I will argue that whatever classification is doing at the end will actually benefit from the short bandwidth, right? So it will learn quickly that if you don't have any onsets Well, at some point it's taking patterns and making a decision about those patterns, right? So how's that different from classification? Whether you do that with a template matching or you do that with a threshold or you do that with picking, you're doing some pattern.
Because I guess that there is much less degree of liberty in the system. So that means that the fact that it will overfit this parameter on the specific case is much more reduced than when you have 50,000 parameters.
And that's a very good point, because I think that the difference, the quantitative difference between what happened before and what is happening now, is simply the new power that we have to overfit the hell out of the data we have, right? So because now we have the power to overfit really well the data that we have to be extra careful about that overfitting, right? Methodologically, I think we were making the same mistakes 10 years ago. It's just that we didn't have machines that were nearly good enough to capitalize on those mistakes. So, all right. But I'm being argumentative for the sake of being argumentative.
Okay, anyway, so let's take the coffee break. So thank you again.
Thank you.